Okay. So let's continue. At the end of the last class, we had completed deriving this, completed to the extent that we were going to, deriving this second order action for gravity. The gravity up, an action that is accurate up to order v to the 4, or Newton's constant squared. Gravity. We'll just try to find an answer, and then we'll look at it for a few. So the Lagrange statement equal to sum over a m a b squared by 2 a 1 plus 3 sum over b k r a b. Is that a m b by square R in B, and then B is not equal to A, it's sum over all. Plus sum over A, M, A, B, E to the 4 by 8, plus A not equal to B, K, M, A, B by 2 RAB. Minus sum over A, sum over B, KMB, KMAMB by 4 squared RAB. Into 7 V A dot V E plus V A dot N A B into V B dot N A B. Find the sum over A B C, not another than already A not equal to B and A not equal to C. K squared M A M B M C divided by 2 R A B R A C. Okay, and let's just look at the terms in this answer. One by one. Okay, so let's see if we can identify some of the terms are obvious that you're familiar with. So what's this term? Classical kinetic energy. What's this term? The correction. So when you do 1 minus d squared, okay, you get 1 minus d squared by 2 plus d to the 4 by 8. It's half. Sorry, expansion of the square root has half in a minus half over 2 factorial. So, this is all. So, this term is with a plus half, but the minus comes from here. Here the minus gets squared, but the expansion is squared into the minus. Okay, so this term here should be the same as this term, except it's b to the 4 by 8 instead of squared. So these two terms just, it's what you would have predicted from special energy. Okay, what's this term? It's the Newtonian potential. It's in the action, so it's minus the Newtonian potential, that's why the plus sign. And we're doing the sum over all A not equal to B instead of summing over pairs. That's why the additional factor of 2. Okay? So this stuff here is completely for me. Okay. Now, the remaining terms are less for me. These terms here represent velocity dependent forces.
terms here represent velocity dependent forces. It tells you that the corrections to Newton's law, due to relativity, the first corrections, give you and order, these are of order v to the fourth, because they've got one copy of Newton's constant, which remember is always treated as order v squared. Okay, times explicitly so this. Okay, and they're velocity dependent forces. They're the same 1 over r type forces, but they're velocity dependent. Okay, and finally, this term here represents a 1 over r square kind of force. Okay, it's not velocity dependent, it's just a 1 over r square kind of force, but it's also a 3 body force. It's a force that depends, it's not that you don't see with 2 bodies. Okay, but you see when you have 3 different bodies. Okay. Okay. And this term here, this term here is of this basic Newtonian form, and I wonder if it can be thought of as you know, but this term is same. You know, this term is basically saying that when things move, the effect of gravitational mass is not quite m. See, you can absorb this term into this term if you wrote down a shifted gravitational mass, which was ma plus ma into 1 plus number times v squared. By choosing the number correctly, this term here would reflect this term. It's interesting that that number involves a 3. Let's do that. Let's do that. So what have we got here? We've got here A I equal to B M A M B B A squared three K by 2 I. Okay? Now, suppose in this expression, we wrote, we replaced MA by curly MA, which is MA plus, in a 1 plus theta, I have the term theta, no? VA squared. Okay, so what would we get? We get a factor of 2, so that will cancel the 2 here. We get theta times K times MA dA squared mb by 2rab. Okay? The 2 was cancelled because I could have chosen the b squared either from the first term or the second. Compare it with this, you see the theta is 3 by 2. And the sine is plus. Oh well, where is the half here, which went away? No, you're saying this by 2 is the same as this by 2? But that by 2 is 1 over e. Alright, there is no one by 2. Because there was a choice of which one to take the v square from. That gives you an extra 5. Okay? So this term here tells you that in a velocity independent way, the effective mass as far as gravitational purposes are concerned, it gets shifted to ma in 1 plus 3 by 2. Okay? Now that accounts for this. This is a pretty tame term. It's a change in the effective mass due to velocity. Okay? These are interesting velocity-dependent forces, and this is interesting three-body force. Of course, if you were to be able to, if it was consistent to be able to continue this to higher and higher order, we would get more and more interesting effects. But as we're now going to see in this class, that it's not consistent to go to arbitrarily high. Okay, fine. Any questions or comments about this? Okay. Okay. Now, in today's class, we're going to talk about this gravitational radiation. Now, mass source gravitational radiation. And the basic point is as follows. You see, we've been trying to find the response. In the last class, we tried to find the response of the gravitational field to second order Newton's constant to a set of particles. And we did this under the assumption that the variation in space and the variation in time of these fields were very different. That things vary over very long periods of time, but the distances over a one in space. Okay, so the basic assumption was that of this and isotropy between space and time. Okay? So this is reasonable for instance the solar system, where the variation in time divided by the variation in space is of things. A measure of that is the velocity of how fast things are moving. So the velocity is small, means things vary over very long distances, long intervals in time, for every interval in space. Now, however, you see, it may be true that your matter particles have this property, that they vary in time over time intervals that are long compared to the space intervals. They're going at small velocities. But it's not necessarily true that the field setup, the gravitational field setup by such a matter particle, will also have this property. Okay? Now, in everything we've done so far, it was true. Because if you look at the perturbation theory that we worked out in the last two classes, and every order in the perturbation expansion, the kind of equation we were satisfying, we were solving, was del squared of some unknown is equal to known. Where del squared was a purely spatial derivative. Okay? And the reason for that was twofold. The equations we were solving, but the reason for that is that we only had to solve the constraint Einstein equations. If you remember, at some point in this course, we discussed that Einstein's equations could be divided into the constraint equations, those that have a zero component, and the dynamical equations, those that don't. And we discussed how the constraint equations never have terms with two time derivatives. They could have terms with one time derivatives, and actually saw terms with one time derivative. Okay? But those terms with one time derivative were set to zero by a choice of each. So, in the end, working in an appropriate gauge, since we only had to solve the Einstein constraint equation, we were always left with solving an equation of this form. Now, an equation of this form determines things time slice by time slice. Given what's on the right hand side at one time slice, it determines something else at the same time slice. Okay? And so if things are varying slowly, if the right hand side is varying slowly, the solution will be varying slowly. That's clear, right? Because it determines things time slice by time slice. So if things are varying, what you'll get is a function of t that will vary slowly if your source is very slow. Okay? All of this is a consequence of the fact that we've so far never needed to solve more than the constraint Einstein equations. Okay. Suppose, however, we have to solve the dynamical Einstein equation. Then what kind of equation are we going to, what kind of equation is going to arise? kind of equation that will arise as we've seen in our study of gravitational waves, and we will see more. Now, is del squared, which is dt squared minus dt squared plus del squared, gradient squared, dt squared minus gradient, minus spatial squared, of unknown is equal to 1? Okay? Now, what can you say about solutions to this equation? Well, what you can say about solutions to this equation, you already know from your courses, of course, on electromagnetics. You know what happens when you solve equations like this. Suppose you've got a source that is distributed however you want. You know, let's say we were back in the way to electromagnetics. You had a charged particle, it was moving with some frequency, and very non-relativistically. Okay? But with some frequency omega. What you will get is, at long distances, by solving this equation, is an electromagnetic wave. The electromagnetic wave will behave like e to the power I omega t minus x. And on this solution, the variation of the solution in space is of same order as the variation of the solution in time. Okay? So, although you started with a source that had that was varying over very long length scales in time and only short scales in space, the solution that you get when you start solving the equations would include field configurations that have variation of the same spatial distance as this very long time distance. Okay? Once you get to the order that such fields are produced, this whole idea of solving the equations in an expansion in velocities, which is based on the separation of scales between space and time, starts breaking down. Okay? So, this whole idea here, this whole idea, which is a very nice idea, is an inherently approximate. Because essentially, of electromagnetism, of in this case, gravity, what we said of electromagnetism will be true of gravity, because in this case, essentially, gravitational radiation. Okay. Now, once we've understood this, you can ask, now, at what order are we going to see, at what order are we going to start seeing these effects? Well, already from what I've said, it's clear that once we start solving the dynamical Einstein equations in some non-trivial context, we're going to start seeing these effects. Now, the dynamical Einstein equations, the IGA equations, precisely if you remember, the equations we didn't need to solve for the last class. Because we never wanted to determine HIJ to order meter of 4. Because its effect from the Lagrangian is always HIJ times VIVJ. So if HIJ is determined to order b to the 4, contributes to the Lagrangian order b to the 6. Okay? But had we needed to go to that order, and had we needed to go to the order b to the 6, we would have to solve for HIJ to order b to the 4. Okay? And that problem, as we're going to see now, as we've already motivated, and we're going to see now what it did, has this problem of breaking the space-time scale separation. Okay? So, this idea of trying to correct Newton's equations in a Lagrangian essentially starts breaking down at order b to the 6th and 9th. Because that's the first order at which we're solving an equation which has two depth, which has in an essential way the time derivatives of it. Okay? And that's the first order at which we start producing gravitational radiation. Okay, now we'll produce a field at order b to the 4th, which will affect the Lagrangian and order 6. Yes, right.
Action that will involve one field and some particle.
Say that again.
Lagrangian that will involve one field and some particle variables.
Okay, I'm not going to try to do more. You're saying how you correct this effect?
Is that what you're trying to
do? No, I'm not. Now I'm going to just give up this effect of action. Okay? Because once you start including the field degrees of variables, you're solving Einstein's equation. I mean, those are all the degrees. You've got Einstein's equations. You know, the thing that we were doing before was integrating out the field degrees of freedom and keeping only the particle integration. Once we go to order v to the sixth onwards, that is an inconsistent field. The Lagrangian starts involving essentially the three degrees of freedom, which you start seeing from the you start producing electromagnetic gradient, which is the same thing as including the field degrees of freedom, which is the same thing as making the approximation in which we were working in the previous class inconsistent. Is this clear? Okay. So now we're not going to own this fact very much, you know. Okay, so Newton's idea was essentially wrong. Because electromagnetism exists. I mean, because gravitational waves exist. So now let's try to characterize these gravitational waves. Okay? So what we're going to do is the following. Where you can imagine that we're working in the same approximations we were in the previous class, everything, matter fields are moving slowly. But now we're going to try to do more than compute the effect of matter particles in themselves. We're going to try to characterize the radiation field set up. Okay? So, before starting this solving process, let me very briefly remind you of what we discussed a few classes ago about free radiation. Okay? If you remember, we looked at an object which is h mu nu minus delta mu nu h alpha mu equals sine mu nu. That's right. And we worked in a gauge in which we worked in a gauge in which psi, del mu psi mu is zero. We noted that this gauge did not completely fix coordinate freedom. It left unfixed coordinate transformations labeled by infinitesimal vectors, such that depth of squared phi is zero. So unfixed. Okay? However, imposing this gauge condition, we found that R mu was simply half box gauge. It's pretty interesting, right? Okay? And so then, what we did was just solve the equation box h mu nu equals zero. Those solutions we know, specializing on harmonic solutions that move in a particular direction, functions of x minus t, which we call x minus. We noted that our gauge condition told us that psi minus mu was equal to zero. And then we used our unfixed coordinate freedom to also set psi plus mu equals zero and psi 2 plus psi 3 equals zero. We could do all of these things. Okay? So what remained was just, so anything involving either a plus or a minus was zero. Inside. All that remained was psi in the 2 and 3 directions. And the, so it's psi from being a 4 cross 4 matrix became a 2 cross 2 matrix. And this 2 cross 2 matrix, the trace part is zero. So there's a traceless 2 cross 2 matrix. Symmetric, of course, like H. So there were two components, that's the off diagonal gang and trace, and the traceless gang piece, okay, which characterize the two polarizations of our. Okay, so this thing was about the discussion of electromagnetic radiation, of gravitational radiation, in the absence of sources. Any questions or comments about what we did? We also promised a problem in your problem set to compute the energy of this. Questions, comments?
Clarify what is gravitational.
If electromagnetism
wave passes, then particle will undergo harmonic oscillation.
Yes.
What happens to the gravitational
wave? Yeah. You know, so a gravitational wave you should think of as a wave of the metric. Okay, so so let's look at it. So suppose we've got a gravitational wave passing this way. Okay, the y and z, the two or three coordinates this way. So h is being turned on in these two directions. Okay, so let's look at the two polarizations. One polarization is hyy minus hz. Okay, the other polarization is hyz. Okay, now in the let's look at what the first polarization is. Okay, so suppose you've got a sine wave for hyy minus hzz, when hyy plus hzz is 0. Okay? So what you're saying is that hyy is equal to hzz. And is equal to minus hzz because hyy plus hzz is 0. Okay? And you've got a sine wave in this. So what that's doing is giving you an increase in distance in y, but a decrease in distance in z. And then at the next trough of the wave, it'll be a decrease in distance in y and an increase in distance in z. So that's what it's doing to geometry. So suppose you had, you know, a bunch of particles that were just sitting here. You'd have to work it out in detail, but roughly speaking, what they would do is that the particles that are here in the y direction go like this, the particles in the z direction go like this. Okay? And then there would be the other polarization that you could. This would turn on some sort of shear. Yes?
So is there something for one particle?
What?
Just one particle?
Well, one particle is like a friend. So the question that you would ask, if you want to ask a physical question, so the kind of question that you would ask is, what is the difference in distances between particles? For one particle, it's a frame dependent question. No, particles always follow its geodesic.
No, I'm saying like the geodesic will change. It won't be.
Yes, it will change. It will change. But, I mean, in this coordinate system, it will move around.
So the other sphere, the ray is propagating in this direction, and not under the fluctuation along the propagation.
That's right. That's right. Basically, you talked about it. This is very similar to the electromagnetic field, where E and B fields are orthogonal to the actual propagation. Yes. Okay.
And what is the other one?
The other one turns on HXY. We'll take HYZ. Okay? So, now, that's a slightly odd thing. See, the thing that we turned on was was just taking distances and changing them a little bit. But hyz is a component of the metric that is not there in flat space. Okay, so now suppose we have a wave in hyz, what would that mean? So let's see what that would mean for distances. Okay, so, suppose we've got hyz turned up. So suppose our metric is ds squared is equal to dy squared plus dz squared plus hyz dyz. Now, what does this space look like? You see, what this is doing, the first thing to say about it, that it's changing angles. But a another way to say it is that it's basically, let me say this. Let's look at this metric. This guy, as a matrix, is this, and let's call this guy epsilon. Okay? Now, let's take this matrix and diagonalize. In this coordinate system, this metric looks complicated. But let's see if we can find a coordinate system in which it looks similar. Okay? So, this is just identity. This is the first Pauli fix. Okay? So, to diagonalize it, is to go to the eigenvalues of the first Pauli matrix. Okay? And these eigenvalues are like 1, 1 and 1 minus 1. Okay? So, basically, these eigenvectors are those, and the eigenvalues are plus 1 and minus 4. So basically, in these directions, this wave will do exactly what we saw in the, shrink here, contract here. Shrink here, expand here. Okay, so it's just like 45 degree rotation of the previous thing. Okay, excellent. Fine. Okay. Now let's move on. Now we want to understand what happens not just in empty flat space, but when there are sources. Okay? So the equation that we're going to try to solve is not Einstein's equations in the absence of matter, but Einstein's equations with matter. So the equation we're going to try to solve is R mu mu. Is equal to t mu nu minus half t mu nu t. And it's, what is it? 4 pi k. This is 8 pi k. 8 pi k. Now, we're going to do all the same things that we did before. Okay? At least in the far field region, we'll work to linearize now that range. When we're far away from these sources. Okay? We'll adopt the same gauge that we did before. Okay? And so this guy once again will become half. So we get half box into union. And then on the right hand side we get lambda h.
But you could ask, when you take Rij
and keep terms that are quadratic in nature? Could you also get terms that are automated? Now this is possible. Because you could, for instance, get a term that is like H00, which is order V squared, you know, times times Hij, which at leading order is also order V squared, as the delta ij of order, times V squared. Okay? So in this equation, it's dangerous to directly substitute Tij on the right, though that's correct in many situations. And many textbooks have generated it. Just do that. You'd land on your feet if you did it in most situations. But if you were being really careful, as we're going to be because we're following good people, you should be a little worried about this. Now you see, if we take this equation was true though, for all components, all the mu components of Einstein's equations. So in particular, it was also true for it was also true for the 0-0 component. Because, you know, we're adopting a kind of gauge that mixes what happens in ij and 0-0. This gauge condition. Okay, now, in the 0-0, we're pretty safe. By just replacing the right-hand side by t0-0. Why are we safe? Because t0-0 is of order 1. Newton's constant gives you order v squared. So the right-hand side for 0-0 is of order v squared. Anything quadratic in h's will be at least order v to the 4. So this, as far as the equation is concerned, let me represent by theta. No, it's now you know what tau mu nu is. Tau mu nu is whatever you get by taking Einstein's equation and keeping all terms of order v to the 4. As when mu nu ij, one such term is k times tij, but there could be other terms. Here, all terms that will lead to keeping leading order for the mu nu of interest. Okay, for ij that would be of order v to the 4. That's what we eventually read. But here, leading order at 0-0 would be just keeping terms that are of order v squared, and that's a unique such term. Anything that involves quadratic or higher order h's is automatically of order v to the 4. Okay, so this equation, what we can in these gauges accurately assert is that this is true. But the thing that we want to calculate is this gravitational variations, this Hij field. Okay? And now we're going to do a few manipulations that allow us to go from solving this equation to solving Hij in the gauge that we're interested in. Okay? And the manipulations go, they're very simple and they go as follows. Look, because our psi obeys this gauge condition, and that's crucial in this whole game. I mean, if you link what's happening in H00 to what's happening in Hij by the gauge condition. Okay? Because our psi is obeying this gauge condition, we can now take this equation and derive an equation that this tau mu nu must have. Okay, so let's do that. So let's write down what let's write down the equation psi. So we get del squared by 2 of course h mu nu minus half h g mu nu eta mu. Is equal to 8πk into tau mu nu minus half tau eta mu nu. Just by tracing the equation, multiplying by eta mu nu, and subtracting half of that equation. Okay? But this now is sin mu nu. So we can take derivative of this is equal to 0 by our gauge condition. So that implies that d mu of tau mu minus
tau by 2 eta by 0.
Or it implies that the effective source obeys an equation very similar to the gauge equation. That is, del mu tau mu nu minus del mu tau by 2. When tau is the duration of time. If tau were the stress energy tensor, but tau, what is tau? So tau is more or less the stress energy tensor. And you know, one of the terms in tau would be the stress energy tensor. And if tau were the stress energy tensor, then this equation would be obvious. It would be just the conservation of the stress energy tensor. Because tau mu is more or less this thing. Okay? So now, this combination gives you back the stress energy density. Let's take that. That if we, suppose we took this object and subtracted trace by 2 times eta mu nu, trace of this object by 2 times eta mu nu, we would get back the stress density. Let's check that. What's the trace of that object? The trace of this object is trace B minus 2 trace D. So it's minus trace D. Okay? So if you subtract half of the trace of that object, you're adding half trace T times eta mu nu to this object. And so you're getting back down. Then T mu. Okay? So, were tau to just have been the stress tensor, this equation would simply have asserted the conservation of the stress tensor. Okay? Now, actually, the stress tensor is covariant zero. It's not absolutely constant. And that is the subtlety in using the earlier kind of argument. But tau, sort of by definition, the thing that's on the right hand side, is actually conserved. Okay, so whatever tau is, we know two things about it. A, that it satisfies this equation, this nice conservation type equation, and B, that tau 0, 0 is T 0, 0. Now we're going to use these two things to process what happens to Hij following. Okay, so let's do that. Okay, so now we can, in order to do that, we use, okay, firstly, what's the solution? So, before we do all of this, suppose we've got the equation of this form, what's the solution? Then you know what the solution is, right? You know that h mu nu is equal to integral, one over r tau mu nu, where this r is at the, is the spatial distance for the causal spatial distance. That is, you take the source, let it emit a light ray. Something that moves at the speed of light from the retarded spatial distance. You know what I mean, right? So R is the spatial distance for the point that is connected to length.
zero. The radiation field at point x is proportional to 1 over the distance of the source, but 1 over the distance when? 1 over the distance of the source at the time at which it was when a light ray could have gone from the source to the point where you're measuring. Okay? So that's represented by this. There's the delta function that tells you, you know, the source overall spatial and time parts, with the delta function that tells you, you pick out the time so that a light ray could have gone from there to the spatial point at the time that you originally given. Okay, so that's the solution, that's with what? With some constants, minus 4. And that's the solution equation. All right. This is tau. Because I equate as tau in the end. Okay? Now, this R here, this x minus y here, is a quite complicated object. It's a quite complicated object. However, if we restrict to sources that are moving slowly compared to the speed of light, if we restrict to sources that are moving slowly, then you can essentially ignore the variation of let me say two things. See, there are two things that are of interest. Firstly, this distance r here depends on where your source is. Okay, you get an extended source, and the distance from source to where you are depends on where your source is. But it's clear that if this distance here, the distance between where you are and where the source is very large, then that difference is only about a 1 over r squared. Because you Taylor expand. Take something that's about 1 over r minus it would be of this form, right? So r squared plus 2 r dot a plus a squared. You take that, expand that. The leading order guy, the 1 over r piece, just said a to z. So the fact that the source is an extended source, when you're looking at a field very far away, that's ignorable as far as the 1 over r part of the field is concerned. Of course, it's important for the 1 over r squared. Okay. However, the fact of when you receive what you receive, this delay because of this delta function in time, that's not necessarily ignorable. However, it is ignorable if everything's moving slow compared to speed. You see, because this time delay between, this guy is moving very slowly compared to the speed of light, the time delay between here and here is basically negligible. Okay, so what I'm saying is something that you might like. I'm saying that in a situation in which we're looking at a field far, very far compared to the size of the thing that's radiating, and where things are also moving very slow compared to the speed of light, we can just pull this radial position. H mu nu in that non-relativistic far field limit is minus 4 pi by r integral tau mu nu of y at the retarded time, and ignore that time effect in this r. Okay,
related this HP new field to this spatial integral of some stress, some effective stress energy tensor source. Now from here on, it's simple algebraic manipulations that give us an answer. Let's do these manipulations. What we want to do is to relate tau ij, this integral of tau ij, over all space to the integral of something involving the integral of t0, tau 0, 0, which we know as the stress tensor, lattice stress tensor. Okay, so we do some interesting manipulations. We first look at these two equations. We separate the two equations that we have, the thing that was essentially okay. Now I'm really sorry. I have to switch back to lambda. I'm really sorry about this. The equation I had written was del box h mu nu is equal to, what was it? 2 is tau medium. Okay, but lambda Lucius works for the different, he works for the equation. Psi mu is equal to psi. Okay, so let me call the tau that I've been dealing with so far tau hat. So everywhere that we've used tau in your notes in the last 10 minutes, that's tau hat. Tau mu nu is defined as tau hat mu nu minus half tau eta mu nu. Tau mu nu is naively just the stress tensor. The thing that follows from our Gauge equation, which was a complicated equation for tau hat, the one that we wrote down, is simply del mu tau mu nu. Okay, so the lambda of way is better. We should use it. It's just a basis change. We take the equations and adding them, but this is the equation we use because we want to follow that. Sorry about that. Okay? So now, from now on, when I say tau, this is what I mean. It's not the tau we had written. The tau we had written before was tau. This is okay, sorry about that. Okay. So, now we're going to do some algebraic processing. And the algebraic processing goes as follows. First, we take these tau mu equations and write them down in the cases that. So, we have. But where one of the free indices is a space index, one of the free indices is a time. Let's do the time index. So that's del I tau 0 I minus del 0 tau 0 0 is equal to 0. Okay? This would have been plus had the contracted index on tau been upper. But it's minus because there's a minus sign in this way. Okay, that's one of the equations. The second equation is the guy with where the free equation index is a free space index. So that's del I tau j I minus del 0 tau j 0 is equal to 0. Just separating that index, that one equation, into two indices, where the free index is either time or space. Now, what do we get from this? Well, look at the following manipulation. Suppose we were interested in del by del x0, del by del t, of integral tau alpha 0, x beta integrated over all space. Okay? Now, for this quantity, I can use this equation. Alpha is g. Let's call it j, and let's call it beta. So this equation, on this quantity, I can use this equation. So
Del by del x0 doesn't actually excite, so that's only in this guy. I use this equation, so that becomes integral del I. Del by del x of m. Del m tau j m x I d3 by. Now this I can rewrite as del m of tau j m x I d3 by minus. Then if we move to here, tau j m delta I m, and therefore tau j I. Because derivative, m's derivative of I is delta m. Okay? Now this tau, whatever it is, will go to 0 and infinity. Because matter sources are assumed to be concentrated, and the remaining parts of tau are like non-linearities. In H, to very small than infinity. So this tau goes to 0 and infinity. So as far as the integral over infinity is concerned, it becomes surface integral at infinity. Forget about it. Okay? So what's left is this guy. So we've concluded that because of this conservation equation, del by del x0 of tau j0 xi d 3y is equal to minus tau ji d3y. Now, on the right hand side, we've got something symmetric between j and I. Left hand side, it's not symmetric. I mean, clearly, we could have interchanged j and I with that. So, the more symmetric version of this formula is half of del by del x0 tau j0 xi plus tau I0 xk d3y is equal to minus tau j I d3. Anyway, these are all space. Doesn't matter. But let's do it the way you want. Yeah, we're raising and lowering with the IG in space. It doesn't matter. Okay. So that's progress. Firstly, we've related this integral tau IJ over space. The thing that we want, the thing that is the source for the HIJ field. To something involving 1, 0 in x and 1, j in x. However, we can do even better. We can relate it to entirely to something involving 2 0 indices. So now what we're going to do is take this object and relate it to an integral over tau 0 0. Okay, in order to do that, we just play the same game. Okay, so the game we play is let's look at del by del 0 of integral tau 0 0 d3 1. And then we use this equation. That is the same thing as integral. Did I want the next size? Sorry. Tau 0, 0, x, I, x. Once again, delta del x0 doesn't act on x, I, x, j. We use this equation. So that gives us del I, let's not call it I, del m tau 0, m. X I X J D3 Y. Now we play the same thing. We know the surface term by integration by parts. So the other terms that we get are ignoring surface terms, we get tau 0 M and delta M I. So that's tau 0 I X J plus tau 0 J X I. The minus sign. Okay? Put this, substitute, take this equation and this equation. What do we find? We find the integral tau ij
3y is equal to d2 by dx0 squared integral tau 0, 0 xi xj.
The minuses are cancelled, maybe we need a half.
Okay, so as long as this source term obeys the conservation equation, which was a necessary consequence of our choice of pH, that source term, whatever it is, it relates the ij source to the 0, 0 source in the scalar way. But the 0, 0 source we know to the approximation that we are interested in working is simply T0, 0. The lowest order stress tensor for matter stress tensor, which is simply so what we conclude is that the lowest order tau ij d3y is equal to half sum over a me xia xja. Okay, and then second type then. Okay, you've got the bunches of particles at locations. Eighth particle at location. XI. Okay? So now, in this so now in this quite nice manner, we have got a nice formula for the effective source on the right-hand side of the equation for Hij. Okay? In terms of what the matter distribution is doing, some moment of the matter distribution, the moment of the mass distribution of your object. Okay? And now they you guys like to put it in some fancy form. So, okay. From now on, the rest is jazz. You see, what we've got here, let me define the formula. Let me define Dij as what they call the quadrupole tensor of the matter distribution. Okay. So let me define that as sum over masses or integral over density. M of integral over rho of x, x, I, x, j, the factor of 3, minus delta I, j, x squared. Okay, so it's this thing with an additional factor of 3 and the trace. So, this is the source in general. We are interested particularly in the source for the traceless spatial components of H, because those are the guys that, in the gauge of interest, will give us electromagnetic radiation. So, for those guys, this source is the same as this source, because up to a number, because the trace part of this anyway. Okay, so in terms of this, we've got a formula which is that H mu nu is equal to, let's check on the factors, minus 2 by 3 or 0 d mu nu. Okay. Now, where do all these factors come from? You see, firstly, we had a half from here.
we had a in a formula for from the Green's function, we had a 4 pi k. That 4 pi k became the k is just there's a k. Just one. The formula inverting this this Green's function was psi was equal to minus 4 integral source divided by r. You can derive that if you want. But anyway, this is the formula for it. Okay. So there was a minus 4, it became minus 2 because of this half, and then it got divided by a factor of 3 because this d here is 3 times this max. Okay? And the removing of the trace is basically irrelevant for the traceless degrees of freedom. Okay. So the net upshot is the following. That this is the formula for the gravitational wave radiated by a collection of particles. That are moving slowly, far away from the particles, and particles that are moving slowly. Competitive. Okay? This object here is clearly a part of e to the fourth because it has one factor of Newton's constant, which we've decided how to v squared, and two time derivatives that will make these things two velocities. Okay? So the v, so what we've concluded now is that the v to the four component of the spatial part of the metric is a radiation field. One that we've computed. Okay? And we've got a formula for the amount of electromagnetic radiation released. Okay, so what you guys are going to do in your problem set is to do various things. First, you will compute the energy of the radiation, energy loss due to radiation in terms of derivatives of these quantum vortexes. Second, you will take an example in which you've got a planet moving around the sun, let's say. Compute how much energy it loses. Due to gravitational radiation. You compute the angular distribution of that energy radiated far away and various such fun things. Okay, you know about this Nobel Prize that was given in 1997 or so for the indirect detection of gravitational radiation. And you had, what was it, a pulsar, I think, orbiting a very massive star or black hole or something like that. Its orbit was measured very precisely. And they could measure it precisely enough to see that it was slowing down. It was losing energy. And that rate of loss of energy was precisely what we were doing. But that was slightly jazzed up version of this formula. That would be interesting. Okay? So this formula tells you how much things radiate. By radiating, they lose energy. As far as the effective motion of particles is concerned, it's dissipative. Things spiral inwards. Planets, and this has been observed. Okay? So we have a number of little problems on gravitational radiation. This is all I wanted to say about the subject. Other than questions or comments. Okay? So, okay, good. So this marks our marks the end of the part of our course, which is dealing with round one on the structure of general relativity and on small tweaking of Newtonian approximations. You know, so far what we've done is describe the theory, the motivation for the theory, we've described the theory, and then basically if you think about it, what we've done is look at how we get the Newtonian limit and how we get small corrections away from it and how we get small effects like gravitational radiation. And this is qualitatively important, okay? But we've always worked in the limit in which h is small. Quite close to flat space, quite close to Newtonian ideas. Okay? Now, the rest of the course, what we're going to do is depart from this timid approach. You see, general relativity is fun and very important in physics because it does work for two reasons. Firstly, because of course it gives you precision ways of calculating things that almost got right by Newton's theory. Secondly, because it predicts entirely new phenomena like gravitational radiation. But thirdly, because there are regimes in which relativistic effects are, even ignoring issues of radiation, are not small perturbations on the Newtonian theory. General relativistic effects give you entirely new phenomena, okay, that really do not have a counterpart. Okay, and the two broad areas of this kind of physics is the study of cosmology, in which general relativity is key. You can't start that study without using general relativity. Okay? And the study of black hole physics. Now the first of these, the study of cosmology, is a very active observational science. Okay? And it's also very active theoretically. I mean, the theory of inflation is being developed even as we speak. You know, it's an old idea, it's 20 years old, but there are many things to do about it. It's not yet clear whether it's correct or form is correct. Okay, it's very active both observationally as well as theoretically. And in some sense, you know, in the broad structure of the scheme of physics today, it's more important than it. However, the study of black holes has an enormous theoretical appeal, for various reasons that we can see. Because black holes, as Chandrasekhar, these are the most perfect objects. They're constituted entirely out of the elements of space-time themselves. Something enormously theoretically appealing about the study of black holes. And generations of physicists have come up with the conviction, that maybe right or wrong, that the study of black holes will teach us something fundamental, will eventually teach us something fundamental about our universe. Okay? Black holes, by the way, are also observational objects. You know, you observe them in the center of the galaxy, you observe with fantastic precision. But in the observational universe, they're a bit of a sideshow. It's not like cosmology. However, theoretically, they're very interesting objects. Okay, so these are the two things that we're going to try to understand through the rest of this course. We're going to try to do now, use general relativity to study cosmology, and use general relativity to study black holes. Okay, so let's start that energy. So, we're first going to start with cosmology. Okay, the black holes will be the last. Okay. So, it's a bit odd to study cosmology 10 minutes. But let's do it anyway. Any questions about it? Any discussion there? Okay. So what is the study of cosmology? Cosmology is the study of the dynamics of the universe as a whole. Okay? And at least in the first part of our study, We will be concerned with the study of cosmology at length scales that are very large compared to the length scales of structure. Large compared to even the length scales of galaxies. Now, if you look at the universe at short length scales, of course, it's a very complicated place. And this chair is here, it's not there. So the universe is not homogeneous. Things are different. Okay, our galaxy is here, it's not there. The universe is not homogeneous. But in a broad statistical sense, if you go to length scales very large compared to the length scales of galaxy or even length scales of clusters of galaxies, observationally, there seems very good evidence that the universe is a pretty, on a broad average statistical sense, is a pretty pretty simple place. Okay? It appears to be both homogeneous and isotropic. Homogeneous means that it's the same at every point. We'll make this a little more precise. But intuitively speaking, if you're here or you're there, you don't see a different universe. There isn't a distinguished location. Isotropic means it's the same in every direction. There isn't a distinguished axis. You could have something that's homogeneous, but not isotropic. For instance, in an experiment in which a water is flowing through a pipe, except that the boundary layers, you know, this thing is basically homogeneous, it's the same at every point. Let's say it's homogeneous in that direction at least. But it's not isotropic. Okay? And you could have. These are different notions. Notions of isotropy and the different of homogeneity, different notions. Both appear to be true. Appear to be true in the universe as we see it today. And anyway, we're going to start our discussion of cosmology with this assumption of homogeneity and isotropy. Okay. Now, so to start a study of cosmology, what we're going to do is to try to say what could the metric of the universe be. We're going to try to write down the metric of the universe that is homogeneous and isotropic to the extent that we understand those ideas in space. But we're not going to demand homogeneity and isotropy in space-time. Because it's not true that the universe looks the same now as it did 5 billion years ago. As we will see, there's observational evidence, and as we will see, through our study, it was hotter 5 billion years ago. So there was a distinguished, there's no translation in dates and time. There appears to be in space, but not in time. Okay? So, the kind of metric that we're going to write down for our universe is going to take the following. We're going to write down a metric that is ds squared is equal to d squared. Minus e squared of t ds3 squared.
So there are models that actually assume time translation in invariance as well. Cosmological models of the universe. Like the steady state theory.
Yes. It's true. There were models historically that assume this. But those models are very much ruled out by data. Steady state theory is an odd theory. It the universe is expanding. Okay. If on the other, that is clear because you observe redshifts. Galaxies are retreating away from you. And the further the galaxy is, the faster it's retreating. That's an observational fact. Argument. So you've got this expanding universe. If in an expanding universe, firstly, nothing's going to change in time, you have to have constant production of matter. Because otherwise, matter gets diluted. Okay? So at a theoretical level, the steady state theory never really got over that. It was a theory that was postulated on violation of conservation of energy. That's possible for the conservation of energy is violated. There are large-scale processes, but there's no evidence for it. Okay. But secondly, if you look at the WMAP data, it seems to show very clear evidence. You know, it's really good agreement with the idea that there was, if not a Big Bang, at least something quite dramatic happening in the beginning and then rapid expansion since dilution of the stress tensor associated with matter, dilution of the stress tensor associated with radiation. Okay, so so I think it's very far from the observational reality that the universe is. There's a certain appeal to the idea that the universe is as it always was. In the informal lecture I gave you when we didn't have a camera. I don't know if you remember, but I told you about how Einstein introduced the cosmological constant. And we'll talk about that. In order to try to make a static universe. But our universe just does not look like that. It may have a cosmological constant. It looks like it does, but it doesn't look steady. We'll discuss much of this as well. Okay? So the observational evidence, at least, indicates the universe is not translational.
Excuse me, sir. So when you consider the Hubble expansion, you say that due to gravitational redshift, we see a shift in the wavelength, right? But how do you compare the velocity vectors of galaxies very far away? Like, you have to take into account the curvature of the space, right?
Yes.
So, how do you get the relative velocity vector between the galaxies and us?
You see, so what you observe is the wavelength of the radiation you see and the intensity of the radiation you see. Let's suppose in a simplified experiment, you knew the absolute brightness of the galaxy, the brightness of the supernova that you were observing. Okay? You measure the observed brightness. So you measure some shift in luminosity. You know, you measure that were the universe to be flat, that would give you the distance to go by the 1 hour on screen. Okay? You measure also the Doppler shift. Were the universe to be flat and spectrally relativistic, that would give you the velocity. So you measure two observational. Now, how do you compare with actual what's actually happening in a body?
But this procedure could give you velocities greater than light.
This procedure could give you velocities greater than light. It's just, these are words to put to things that you measure. The thing that you have to compare it with is this is what we're going to be doing over the next 3 weeks. Okay? What predictions you get out of the real model of the universe. So you make a model of the universe, we'll write down a metric for the universe. It'll be parameterized by a few parameters. In such a metric, I'll be able to predict for you Doppler shift versus luminosity of source. But the question that you're asking is premature because we have to set up the model first. In that model, we will not, you know, the word distance will be a bit imprecise. The word velocity will be a bit imprecise, but anything measurable, like if you want a curve of observed luminosity, which is an experimentally measured thing, versus the Doppler shift, we'll predict a clear curve. And then you go and check it against your experiment. So you don't have to talk about distance, you don't have to talk about velocity, talk about observance. Okay, once you have the model, you can predict anything that you can measure. And we'll do it. Okay? Good. So, this is the kind of metric we're going to assume describes our universe. Well, so far I've not said much, but I have made some assumptions. The assumptions I've made are that it's GS3 squared. Okay, is a spatial metric. Okay, so DS3 squared is a metric in spatial coordinates. Doesn't involve time. Okay, all time dependence in this metric is an overall prefactor multiplying the spatial metric. Moreover, I'm going to assume that this spatial metric is both homogeneous and isotropic. Now the great thing about this assumption is that there is a little body of, actually quite a large body of mathematics that allows you to classify all completely symmetric spaces, which is the mathematical way of saying that space is homogeneous and isotropic. Okay? And that classification, given the signature of the space, in this case our space completely Euclidean signature, pure spatial. And given the signature of that space, the classification is essentially a one-parameter classification. Okay, depending on the curvature of the space, the Ricci scale of the space. You give one number of the space, namely, for instance, the Ricci scale of the space, and mathematics plus the assumption of maximal symmetry determines the space for you in terms of the number. Okay? That also justifies putting the overall time dependence outside. Because, you know, if the thing is maximally symmetric, the only thing that can change is that one, as far as space concerned, is that one number, which can be a function of time, of course. Okay? But, you know, the whole metric of the space is
determined up to an overall prefect. Okay, in the next class, I may give you a few more details about this mathematical classification. Okay, but just a few books. It's not our intention to go into classification.
Classify the shape or the
full metric.
But the shape is Euclidean.
We're assuming that the signature is Euclidean.
No, as in the coordinates you choose are minus infinity to plus infinity.
No, everything. Just assume that locally, the eigenvalues of the metric has three positive, the metric has three positive values at any given point. So that's the signature of the metric.
The shape of this one, finally the right coordinates dx squared, dy squared, dz squared.
No. Not, okay. One of the manifolds we get in is an S3. So, what its topology is also, will come out of this.
Isotropy doesn't imply it has to be sphere.
It doesn't. Well, for instance, it would be R3. R3 is a beautiful homogeneous isotropic manifold. It's not a sphere. S3 is one of these. But there's one more. It's like a hyperbola. Okay, and these manifolds are the manifolds where this Ricci curvature takes the value 0 for flat space, a positive number for the sphere, or a negative number for the diagonal. Okay, so we're going to so in the next class I may give you some more details of this classification, but that's not many more because that's not our intention. We don't want to get into mathematics. Okay. I'm going to ask you to take it from me. But I'll give you some more details just so that you know under what mathematical conditions this theorem is. Okay? Then I'll quote the theorem, which is very nicely discussed in Weinberg's paper. Okay, so if you're interested, curious about it, read it. But the important thing for us is that these three manifolds, once you know that it's unique, it's very easy to construct this. So, of course, there's R3. Then there's nothing to construct, right? Okay. So one of them is R3. AS3 squared is equal to dx squared plus y squared plus z squared. And R is equal to 0. Now, what are the other members? But the other obvious manifold is an S3. Okay? Clearly an S3 is homogeneous, every point is the same. Isotropic, every direction is the same. Okay? So this manifold, without any fancy mathematics, we know what it is. Let's discuss it. Okay. So we've got for this S3, we have okay, so let's think of S3. So S3 can be thought of as x squared plus y squared plus, let's think of this, x1 squared plus x2 squared plus x3 squared plus x4 squared is equal to a squared. So it can be thought of as a three-dimensional submanifold of R3. Okay? And there are two coordinate systems we will find useful. Is one in which we single out these three directions and write these three directions as a two-sphere times radius. And then we use as coordinates on this manifold the radius of this two-sphere and the angles of the two-sphere. Let's do that. So what am I saying? I'm saying we write x2 as equal to sine theta, let's say cos psi, x3 is equal to, it'll be more traditional if we single out these three. x1 is equal to r sine theta,
theta cos phi, x2 is equal to r sine theta sine phi, and x3 is equal to r cos theta. Of course, now you have plus x4, it's the double base equation. X4 is square root. Metric of S3 in these coordinates? Well, that's very simple. It's the metric of R4. So the metric of R4 is dx1 squared plus dx2 squared plus dx3 squared plus dx4 squared. Substitute these in here. Okay, so what do we get? Well, suppose we do the substitution of x1, x2, x3 in here. This d can act on the theta squared, d can act either on r or on theta and phi. The part where it acts on theta and phi is clearly something. Can somebody tell me what? The metric on an S2. This S2 is size R. That's why the R squared. Okay? Now, what about terms in which one D acts on an R and the other D acts on theta and phi? Those vanish. Why? What such a term under rotations, SO3 rotations of the S2 would be a vector with one index on the S2 and one index on the other side. But the metric that we have here is rotationally invariant. Does there exist a rotationally invariant vector field in S2? No. Vector spherical harmonics always start at A. There's no A equals 0 in this. No rotationally invariant vector field. Okay, so on general grounds, of course we work it out happens, but on general grounds you know that there can't be a dr times d theta phi. So what's left? What's left is we could get d acting on r. So here what will we get? We get dr squared, and from the x, then we will get this stuff squared plus this stuff squared plus this stuff squared. What is this squared plus this squared plus this squared? What? That was the reason for the characterization. That's why we put it this way of solving, right? So we get dr squared from here. And then in x4, we'll also have a d acting on x4. X4 is, so we'll get what? Plus half minus R the whole thing squared, a square minus r squared